my mind. Two of a kind, but one won't survive. My image is reflecting the enemy's eye, and his image is reflecting mine at the same time. I against die. Flesh in my flesh and mind in my mind. Two of a kind, but one won't survive.
Hey there, Nation, and welcome to another episode of the Underhive's Most Wanted. This series is dedicated to the analysis of the Dramatis Personae fighters in Games Workshop's Necromunda. In this series, we will discuss the characters' rules, equipment, their strengths and weaknesses, their positive and negative impact on gameplay, and provide other critical information to help you to dominate in your next campaign of Necromunda. And in today's episode, this focus will be on the Deserter, the ex-soldier bounty hunter, as well as Dramatis Personae that you can recruit in your gangs in your future campaigns. So let's go ahead and go a little bit on a deeper dive on the Deserter and talk about their rules, their strengths and weaknesses, as well as a positive and negative impact on gameplay. So the Deserter is an interesting character. Narratively speaking, he's supposed to be a legendary Necromunda 8th soldier from the 8th Regiment of Necromunda, who is a deserter who actually kind of helps out gangs from time to time and also collects bounties to make extra money. Now, for his rule set, the Deserter costs 225 credits, and for his stats, he has 4-inch movement allowance with a 3-plus weapon skill and a 4-plus weapon skill. He has 3 strength as well as 4 toughness. He has 2 wounds, a 4-plus for initiative, 2 attacks. And for psychology stats, he has 7-plus for leadership, 6-plus for cool, 7-plus for willpower, and 8-plus for intelligence. Now, your gang will need to pay a credit amount of 225 credits in order to recruit this fighter to join your gang, so he is kind of pricey. He is also a bounty hunter, so bounty hunter special rules will also be part of his rule packet as well. Now, when it comes to his weapons real quick, he is armed with a shotgun with both solid as well as scatter shot. He also comes equipped with frag grenades as well as a fighting knife. And for his skills, he has a Medicaid as well as Mentor and Overseer skills. And for his war gear, he has armor, undersuit, as well as flak armor. And these are the things that the Deserter will be bringing for your guys' campaigns if you decide to hire him for your gang. So now that we're done talking about his rules real quick, let's go ahead and talk about his strengths as well as positive impact on gameplay. So first of all, let's talk about the strengths and the positive impacts that this fighter actually brings to your gangs. First of all, he is a pretty decent fighter, and he has pretty decent gear to fight with as well. He has a 3-plus weapon skill as well as 2 attacks on base, which is going to make him very good for close combat, especially consider the fact that his weapons are more close range oriented. What that also means too is that if he charges directly into close combat, he's going to have 3 attacks on base with that 3 of weapon skill, which is kind of nice. Now, unfortunately, he's only strength 3, which is not so great, but he is toughness 4, so because of that, it will be a little bit more difficult for your enemies to wound him in close combat as well, provided that they don't have actually any weapons that give him any additional bonuses to strength. You're probably looking around a 5 up in order to wound this character. Plus, with his 2 wounds, is pretty survivable as well. Now, at the same time, even though he has kind of a pretty decent skill set for close combat, his ranged weapons, however, aren't all that great. He does have a shotgun. Shotguns are pretty good because you got the different types of load that you can use for them. For the solid shot, which would be the longer range shot, he has an 8-inch range on that with a 16-inch maximum long range distance on that. And you also get +1 for the short range bonus on that one. So long as you're within 8 inches, you'll probably hit enemies on a 3-up in most cases. Now, the nice thing about that is the solid slug does have strength 4. It does cause 2 damage. It's also got an armor roll of 4-up, and it also has knockback, which means that since most of your enemies will probably be around toughness 3 for the most part, unless you're fighting House Goliath, you'll be wounding on a 3-up and also causing 3 damage because of that knockback rule, and also pushing your opponents off of the edge of buildings, walkways, that sort of thing as well. Now, even if you are facing against Goliath, so it's still a 4-up, which is still pretty good, all things considered. And of course, you do have Scattershot. Scattershot does have 4-inch range as well as an 8-inch long range. You get 2-up on the short range, so that means you'll be hitting your opponents on a 2-up. If you're within that 4-inch range. Now, the only problem with Scattershot, of course, it only has strength 2, but it does have the Scattershot attribute, which means that it will be able to cause D6 wound rolls, so if numbers are on your side, it can help you out. For example, Scattershot's perfect to use against enemies who have already been inflicted by flesh wounds because their toughness is less, so using Scattershot could be potentially very devastating as well. Now, he does have frag grenades, which is also kind of nice as well, which means he'll have a 9-inch range when he throws a frag grenades with a 3-inch blast with knockback. Frag grenades are perfect for pinning enemies and things of that nature. But even though he's got pretty decent weapons and equipment, though, you're not really going to be using him for his fighting skill too much. You're going to be using him more of a support fighter. And the reason why you'll be using him more of a support fighter is because of the skills as well as equipment that this character comes with as well. He's going to really be more of a support in terms of providing bonuses to your teams, your fighters, providing bonuses to your experience buffs, as well as also supporting anybody who's also been injured as well. The way I like to look at the deserter is that I don't like to look at the deserter as a bounty hunter or a fighter per se. I like to look at him as a second in command character that would be supporting your leader that you can hire for your gang, because that exactly is where he kind of shines, in my opinion, is with those skills, with those psychological stats. He's going to do a lot of good for your army, especially if you decide to use him a certain way for your gang and use those buffs. It's really going to help you out. Alright, so let's talk about those positive impacts on gameplay and why he's such an important person to have around for support fighting. First of all, he does have the Medicaid skill, and that's going to make him extremely invaluable for a lot of your fighters. Because if anybody's ever known who's gotten fighters who've gotten seriously injured or have been taken down, having that ability to re-roll injury dice is extremely important. He's going to help your fighter stay more into the game. So if you do roll that unfortunate skull for the out of action, he can help re-roll that for your fighters by being within 3 inches of them. Instead, what they can do is do things like give him flesh wounds or give him a serious injury instead. Or if your men are seriously injured, you could hopefully get those flesh wounds to get them back on their feet again and put them right back in the fight. So having that character do that is really good. Plus, since he's armed with a shotgun, he can also defend people who have also been taken, who have also been seriously injured, which is also kind of nice too with that short range attack. At the same time, he also has the mentor skill, which is really nice as well. Now, for those of you guys who are unaware what the mentor skill is kind of a neat kind of game mechanic. And what it basically does is it helps support your fighters by giving them better better experience buffs later on. Which would end up happening is this. This is how pretty much how mentor pretty much. You make a leadership check with this fighter, which is a 7+, which would be pretty easy to get most of the time. And you pick another fighter within 6 inches of him at that point if they manage to earn a point of experience. If you do so, instead of just getting 1 point of experience, you actually get 2 points of experience instead. So if you're looking for a way to level up your fighters, especially like juvies or fighters who are going to be fighting close combat, who will be taking out enemies on the regular, having them around, having them pass that leadership test will double the amount of experience points they get for doing things like taking out your enemies, for example, close combat. Or you could also stick them with your juvie level fighters as well. Anyone who's ever used juvies before know that they have a bad tendency of breaking because of failing cool checks, and they get an automatic get an automatic experience point if they manage to recover their nerve. If he's within range, he can actually double that experience gain. So like I said before, you're going to use him more of a support fighter than an actual combatant because of these buffs that he gives your gang. And probably one of the coolest things about this character, he does have the Overseer ability, the Overseer skill, and he can actually give that Overseer skills to your fighters. He can actually give them those orders and give out those double sets of activations, which is really cool. So for example, if you have a ganger or a fighter who's armed with an assault weapon like a grenade launcher or a plasma gun or a melta gun or a flamer, this person can give those fighters double sets of activations. So you can fire those weapons twice, you can move and then fire and then move again, or you can send guys in a double charge for charging twice in close combat. There's pretty much limitless things you can do with this guy. And those skills alone, the Medicaid skill, the mentor skill, and the overseer skill, just those alone will be really worth actually paying the credit price for this fighter to help out your gang members. Now, let's go ahead and talk about the weaknesses and negative impacts on gameplay for this character as well. First and foremost, the "we'll get our bit" special rule will sting you quite a bit. That's pretty much where the bounty hunter leaves your service because they feel like they've pretty much gotten all the bounties they can out of joining up with your gang. And that "we'll always get our bits" special rule is always a problem that you're going to face whenever you have bounty hunters. Granted, it's very rare when it happens, but when it does, though, it can be kind of pricey. Spending 225 credits for your gang on this fighter just to have them leave after one potential battle is not good whatsoever. And that's the reason why a lot of people don't actually hire Dramatis Personae bounty hunters for the most part, just because they're afraid they'll have them leave your service after you just recruit them for one single battle. So that could be a huge problem for that one. At the same time, another negative impact against the deserter is that because the deserter does such a good job of providing those supports for your enemy, for your gangs, providing that Medicaid skill to help reroll with wounds, providing those bonus experience points, Overseer alone will make the deserter a bullet magnet. If your opponent knows who the deserter is and what they can do for your gang, they're going to make this guy a target. This guy's going to become a target priority for them. They'll be spending their best weapons, their best fighters to go after him. Now, you could argue, of course, since your opponent is focusing on the deserter instead of your gang, that could be kind of a good thing. And in certain circumstances, that would be true. But don't forget, you're also spending 225 credits on this guy as well, so you really don't want him leaving if he's getting shot at or stabbed all the time. So that's one of the problems that you'll face with him. Another thing about this character that's also negative is the weapons he has. So he only has a shotgun and knife as well as grenades, frag grenades to use. He doesn't have anything beyond 16 inches, so because of that, he's going to be a very short range fighter only. And I think that's on purpose, to be honest. And the reason why is because this character is a support character. You're supposed to use him as a second in command type character, keeping him around other fighters to give him those experience bonuses, to help them give an overseer, also to trigger rerolls and Medicaid skill and stuff. So I think that's why the character's only got short range weapons. The guy only needs weapons to protect himself is what it is. And that could be also a bad thing too, because that means you gotta dedicate some fighters in order to protect them as well. So that could be a negative consequence of that. Another problem with the deserter is because he is a Dramatis Personae character, you cannot upgrade him with better equipment or with better weapons or with different equipment at all. So he does have a nice armor save because he has an armored undersuit as well as flak armor, and combined together will give him a 5 of armor save, but that's really about the only thing he has going on. He doesn't have access to field armor, he doesn't have access to better armor as well, or better weapons. For example, I can imagine this guy being quite deadly being equipped with a hotshot last rifle with a telescopic sight, for example. He'd be pretty deadly that way as well, which is kind of interesting because, you know, as an Imperial Guardsman or former Imperial Guardsman, that would actually make sense. Another problem with him as well is that he is a Forge World exclusive miniature. So if you're one of those kind of players who use WYSIWYG for your gang. Now for those of you who don't know what WYSIWYG stands for, WYSIWYG is an acronym standing for what you see is what you get, which means that what you're looking on the tabletop is exactly what it is. So if you're WYSIWYG and you want to use the official Forge World miniature, it can be kind of pricey to get this. Now, there is a positive to this, however. If you decide to buy the deserter, he is in a pack with another bounty hunter called the Umbra, who is another decent bounty hunter character too. So if you want to kill two birds with one stone and get two bounty hunters, that would be kind of cool. But if you're just trying to get him by himself, though, he can be kind of pricey. My recommendation to you is to convert your own. He's going to be very easy to convert because he's an Imperial Guardsman originally. He's a deserter from the Imperial Guardsman. So just get an Imperial Guardsman miniature, slap on a shotgun or a weapon that looks like a shotgun on him. Maybe you can just cut off the barrel of a last gun, for example, and then bam, you got yourself your own deserter. So that could actually work out as well. In fact, if I was to use the deserter for my gang, that's exactly what I would do. I would just convert my own. So these are some of the weaknesses as well as negative impacts that the deserter has for your gang. So in conclusion, the deserter isn't actually a very good investment for your gang. Unlike other bounty hunters who are kind of like, you could probably take or leave, I would say the deserter actually is worth his price and credits. He actually is kind of pricey, I will admit that, in terms of points for your gang, but it's actually quite worth it. And the reason why is because you can use those buffs that he gives to your gang for injury rerolls, for more experience, as well as the Overseer skill alone. Pretty much Overseer is worth its weight in gold, so he'll be worth every penny in that one. On the side note, if you decide to play an Outcast gang, which is actually a very viable option now, you could actually use the deserter as the leader of your Outcast gang. And he would actually make a very excellent leader. He's got good psychological stats, he's got a good base of skills to go off of, he has pretty decent equipment for him, so he would not be a bad Outcast leader. You could probably put a survivor archetype on him with Nerves of Steel for your skill to make sure that if he does get shot, he can escape pinning just passing cool tests. So that part is kind of neat. Now, unfortunately, when it comes to all Forge World exclusive miniatures, they're kind of like in a strange place for a lot of Necromunda players. The reason why is because for a lot of Necromunda players, they are too expensive in both terms of points for their gangs, as well as their pocketbooks to purchase the miniatures as well. Unfortunately, for Forge World miniatures, for those who are living outside of the UK, shipping costs really add to the price of these. So that's one of the negative aspects about being a Forge World exclusive. But at the same time, you also got to spend quite a bit of credits for your gang to hire these bounty hunters. And by the time you accrue enough credits to hire these bounty hunters, chances are your gang is pretty deadly on its own and doesn't really need a lot of help to do so. So that's one of the problems with it. However, though, if you're willing to put in the 225 credit investment to get the deserter, I say he's worth including your gang. The positives that he has outweighs the cost of investment for this character, and I highly recommend that you take him so that way you can get those buffs that you need for your gang to be successful. So there you guys have it. That's going to do it for this episode of the Underhive's Most Wanted, our analysis of the deserter, the Dramatis Personae bounty hunter, who's an ex-soldier. As always, please feel free to like, comment, and or subscribe. Your guys' input is invaluable to us as always. Also, check us out on Facebook, Instagram, as well as blogger.com for all the latest, greatest hobby news related to this channel. That's good for this week, guys. We'll catch you guys next one. Peace out and stay classy.